My God, he was tired. Wounded, bloody, fearful. Dirty, sweaty, mind-numbing tired. But still dangerous, and if necessary, ready for action. But wishing that he could just go to sleep. SOG-10, team leader of Recon Team Vermont, Sergeant Franklin Miller, had a sucking chest wound. His left arm was shattered and useless, and he was tired. He looked around the crater at his men. Two were dead and had been left behind where they had fallen. Two were hurt so bad that they were unable to defend themselves, let alone help the team. That left two wounded men who could help for a while until they bled out, passed out, or were killed. They had been inserted at 8 o'clock that morning. Now it was about an hour till last light, and with darkness, the NVA would overrun their position. Darkness meant death. Another 7-man SOG team would go down as wiped out. 3 wounded men could not hold out through the night. So Sergeant Franklin D. Miller thought, this is how a SOG team dies. His men were watching him and waiting for him. He was the most experienced, the best trained, the luckiest recon man ever. He was their only hope. If they were going to die here or not, it would be up to him. He knew that, and it weighed heavy on his mind. They were relying on him. He was their last hope. So he would reach down inside and pull up the last of his reserve strength. All SOG-10s had it and knew how to access it, but his well was running dry. With effort, he propped himself up on his good elbow and looked over the berm. His head ached, his eyes ached, his whole damn body ached, and here they came for the third time, a human wave. He raised his weapon and began shooting them. He took his last hand grenade, rolled over onto his back, then, holding the grenade between his knees, he pulled the pin with his good arm, and with the last of his strength, he threw it over his head into the charging hordes. He was hallucinating, 'cause when he looked up, he saw a mountain yard staring down at him, and he thought, I must be dead. Then he saw another and another, and then they were everywhere, surrounding him and his team, standing between his team and the enemy. He looked again, and they were caring for his team, putting on fresh bandages, starting IVs, holding, encouraging, and caring for his men. There were 2 full body bags being carried out of the crater. He couldn't see them or feel them, and he didn't remember them later, but tears were running down his cheeks. He'd been saved, and tears were his last and only weapon. Where had it all begun? He faintly remembered the landmine, but that's not where it started. He went back to the LZ and knew that it had begun before that. His mind was wandering. He remembered when he first came to Vietnam, 2.5 years ago, where he had learned the recon trade with the 1st Cavalry Division. He worked hard and earned the respect and rewards of a top recon man, Silver Star, Bronze Star, Purple Hearts. More important than the medals was the respect he saw in the eyes of his fellow recon men, the acceptance by these men of his talent. Recovering from wounds in an army hospital, he met up with a couple of Green Berets who told him about Mac V. SOG and their top secret missions into Cambodia, Laos, and North Vietnam. He decided to try his trade in the big leagues. Like everyone else, Sergeant Miller had to volunteer for Mac V. SOG. Upon acceptance and on a trial basis, he was assigned to Command and Control Central, Con Tum, Vietnam, where he proved his worth and became a 10, the leader of a recon team, Recon Team Vermont, where he was to become a legend and earn a reputation as one of the baddest boys in the bush. On the day he earned the Medal of Honor, he never made it to his objective. 5 January 1970 was cloudy and getting cloudier. The ceiling was low and the horizon barely visible. From intelligence, he knew that a mile-wide hole in the clouds was drifting down from China directly over his insertion point into Laos. He was timing the insertion to meet that hole in the clouds. Once the team was on the ground, the cloud hole would move away and diminish. Eventually, it would fold itself into the billowing mass and disappear. The team would be on its own, deep behind enemy lines inside Laos. He knew that on that side of the border, the fence, as Sog people called it, there were no friendlies. The team would depend on each other, and they knew that the odds they were facing would be more than 100 to 1, 7 men against 700 or more. When they arrived at Dock To, the launch site, their mood was light and airy. The air crews were friendly and joked with the team. But the moment the team got on the slicks, their attitudes changed. Small amounts of adrenaline entered their systems. Nerves tightened, eyes hardened. They were getting mentally prepared for combat. All SOG teams were giving a primary objective and a secondary objective to recon, do a wiretap, snatch a POW, plant mines, or observe and gather information. Miller's primary target was to find and get the coordinates of a suspected NVA base camp in the area where thousands of the enemy would be bivouacked. His secondary target was a crashed U.S. intelligence gathering airplane that had been shot down the day before. The crashed airplane was closest to the insert location and on the way to the primary target, so it would be their first destination. They reached the downed aircraft within 20 minutes of landing and found it surrounded by a 40-man platoon. The enemy was using the crashed plane as bait for a rescue attempt. The SOG team backed away, slowly, quietly, cautiously, until they were safe. They took a break about a mile from the crash site. Sergeant Miller entered the crash location coordinates into his notebook, then radioed the information to Covey, who was flying overhead, and would call in airstrikes on the unsuspecting enemy platoon. It would be an air ambush. The SOG team stayed wide of the crash site and proceeded to the primary objective. As they quietly moved toward their primary, one of the yards saw something suspicious on the trail. He held up his hand, stopping the members of the team who were behind him. Unaware of the pause, Sergeant Miller and his point man continued on. A huge explosion erupted to their rear. Looking back, Miller saw one of his men staggering out of a gray cloud of smoke and debris, his weapon missing, his clothes mere rags, his bloody body filled with shrapnel. A booby trap had wounded everyone behind Miller and the point man. It also alerted any enemy within sound of the explosion. Miller began to move back to aid his team when he caught movement out of his right side peripheral vision. NVA soldiers were coming to investigate. He crouched and opened fire on his enemy. His point man joined him, and they killed the first 4 or 5 soldiers. The others retreated. The hillside to his left seemed to start sprouting NVA as they rose up from the tall grass, moving toward the ambush site where Miller's team lay bloodied and wounded. The enemy was unaware of Miller and his point man on their flank. A flank ambush is one of the most effective against an enemy in the open. Miller and the point man opened fire and hit 7 or 8 enemy soldiers. When the NVA realized that they were being ambushed, they turned and fired on Miller, then realized that they were shooting through their own men, wounding and killing some. They retreated. Miller and the point man were not hurt, but they didn't know the condition of the team, so Miller went back to help them, if he could. All were still alive. All were wounded. All needed help. Miller carried one and dragged another across a rocky stream and into the relative safety of the thick bushes on the opposite side of the stream. The point man carried one on his shoulder and dragged another across the stream, then they went back for the others. A bloody trail marked the path to their new location. Blood. Blood was everywhere inside their perimeter. Miller reported the team's condition and location to headquarters, then declared a tactical emergency. When a team leader, the 1-0, declares a tactical emergency, it alerts the chopper pilots and the bright light team to be ready to go in to assist, rescue, or recover the remains of the recon team. Everyone put on their gear and prepared themselves for combat, but they did not launch. They were ready and monitoring the radio for a prairie fire emergency, which meant that the recon team was surrounded and in imminent danger of being overrun. The first of his wounded, a mountain yard, died around noon. Miller set up his perimeter across the stream with a clear field of fire in case the enemy decided to attack from that direction. His men were too seriously hurt to move at this time. The terrain above him rose sharply. Miller decided to reconnoiter the area to his rear to find a better defensive position for his crippled team. As he began his search, he heard movement and voices on the ridge above him. The bad guys were coming down the slope, and there were a lot of them. At the same time, another force was coming from the opposite direction across the stream from them. He was caught in a vise. When he got back to the team, he saw that two of his men had recovered enough that they could move on their own. They moved slowly, but it was enough to relieve part of Miller's burden. Two were incapable of moving. They lay on the ground, working for each breath, bleeding. A blood trail led from the explosion site to the team's position. One of the enemy on the far side of the stream found their blood trail and shouted to his comrades. He followed the trail across the stream to within 15 yards of the stricken team. Miller shot him. Then all hell broke loose as every one of the bad guys opened up on Miller. The enemy had set up a machine gun, and it too opened fire on him. Miraculously, no bullets hit him or the point man. When the enemy paused for a moment, Miller threw a tear gas grenade. The gas formed a cloud that engulfed the enemy, who retreated to escape it. Miller threw a white phosphorus grenade to further make them miserable. White phosphorus mixed with tear gas holds the gas closer to the ground, making it even worse for the victim. The gas would keep them at bay for a while, but Miller would have to move his team, hurt or not. In order to save them, he would have to risk their lives. His two walking wounded moved to the new site on their own, while Miller and his point man each carried one of the two wounded to the new position, 100 yards parallel to the stream. The dead mountain yard was left behind. Inside the new position, Miller got on the radio to report his new location and his situation. It was 1 o'clock in the afternoon. 20 meters to the left of the perimeter, the grass moved and shots were fired at the team. The point man was killed instantly, leaving Miller the only one not wounded. He opened fire and threw grenades to break up the new attack. Again, the enemy retreated. A desperate situation requires desperate measures, and Miller took them. He hid and camouflaged his wounded team members, then moved out, alone, in the direction of the enemy. He had decided to ambush his enemy, a one-man ambush against a 40-plus-man platoon. He found a good hiding place behind a large rock and some fallen trees. Within seconds, the platoon came out of hiding about 20 yards away. They were not alert and did not suspect that their enemy was close. Miller began shooting them. One man carried a machine gun. Miller shot him first, then another one. The rest of the enemy platoon took him under fire. Miller killed the point man. Then a grenade landed near him and exploded. The fallen tree absorbed most of the blast, but Miller was knocked out, wounded, and disoriented. Just as his head cleared, two NVA came around one of the fallen trees, searching for him. He shot them both. Miller went back to his team. He looked into the camouflage covering his team and saw blood-red bandages that were unable to stem the flow of his team's life. Covey came up and told him that there was a crater about 200 yards to his east. Miller decided to scout the route alone before moving his team. There was no activity anywhere along the way. When he got to the crater, he lay on his back, and using his mirror, he flashed Covey to let him know the new position. He started back to the team when suddenly he flopped to the ground, confused about how he had gotten there. He fought to get himself to a sitting position, and when he did, he vomited. Blood and puke stained his uniform. He was wounded. He had been shot. It was a surprise to him. He had always felt that he was bulletproof. Now he had one of the most feared of all wounds, a sucking chest wound. A sucking chest wound happens when a bullet or a piece of shrapnel enters your chest, collapses your lung, then exits your back. It makes a hole completely through you. When you breathe in, it makes a sucking sound. The only way to stop the sound is to bandage the wound. It must be an airtight bandage so that the air cannot escape through the holes in your body or build up air pockets inside that will suffocate you. A large piece of plastic would do the job. He tore open the field dressing he carried with him. Using the plastic from the bandage, he plugged the hole in his chest. Then he wrapped the long bandage around his chest and back and pulled it as tight as possible before tying it. Now, all he had to do was make the exit wound in his back airtight. He cut a piece of rubberized nylon out of his poncho liner. Then, feeling his way, he pushed it between his wound and the bandage. It helps to have a buddy do that kind of work for you, but Miller was alone. He doesn't remember doing it, but his survival testifies to the fact that he did do the job alone. Miller was now one of the seriously wounded. Somehow, he got back to the team. He almost passed out from the pain, or maybe he did pass out. He doesn't remember. Then, moving on hands and knees and belly, he dragged, pushed, pulled, and prayed each of his team members the 200 yards to the crater. It took several trips. Inside the crater, he set up a 3-man perimeter facing the enemy who were preparing to charge the wounded SOG team. Just as he was catching his breath, a large force assaulted the crater. Bullets flew, grenades flew. Then, to add to the bedlam, a Huey helicopter appeared out of nowhere and distracted the enemy, who took it under fire with mortars, anti-tank and anti-aircraft rockets, and small arms fire. There had to be 50 or more enemy troops attacking the helicopter. It was hit multiple times, but it flew away under its own power. Suddenly, silence enshrouded the battlefield. The chopper was gone, and now the enemy had only the team to focus on. But they didn't come. Miller figured they were using the team as bait for a rescue effort. After a long wait, the NVA grew tired of the game and decided to wipe the team out. They charged en masse. A human wave assaulted the 3 SOG team members. The team gave as good as it got and forced a retreat. With only 3 men capable of defending their position, Miller decided to take the initiative again. It was 4:00 in the afternoon. Ammo was running low. Daylight was fading fast, and the night held only death for the team. Miller moved painfully out of the crater with the intent of again ambushing his enemy, a 1-man ambush against overwhelming numbers. He found a place behind a large rock with good camouflage about 30 yards outside the crater where he set up his ambush. He heard the NVA massing for the attack against his men in the crater, and he knew that Recon Team Vermont would become another SOG team lost to the enemy. Because of the top-secret nature of SOG, their mission, their location, their existence would not be recognized. The family of these men would be told that their sons had been killed in action somewhere in South Vietnam. His tormentors were 15 yards away when Miller opened fire, surprising them. The enemy expected resistance only from the crater. His fire dropped several of them. The others opened fire on Miller's hiding place. An anti-tank rocket hit the front of the rock where Miller was hiding. It exploded, doing him no harm. Following the explosion, the enemy began their assault against his position. Miller threw his last hand grenade, and it broke up the charge. Several more of the enemy were killed. The rest regrouped and again charged. They would easily overtake Miller's position this time. He threw the last two tear gas grenades. Again, the discouraged enemy was routed. As they retreated, Miller withdrew back to the crater. He got safely inside when the enemy assaulted through the gas. With the other two wounded gunners to help out, the onslaught slowed, then stopped, 10 meters short of the crater's lip. Miller shifted to a new position and was shot in his left arm. He tumbled into the crater, his arm bleeding and useless. He looked up and saw that his two remaining men had been seriously hurt again. They were now unable to fight this battle. It was 7 o'clock and the night was near. Darkness meant death. Headquarters had realized the team was getting its ass kicked bad, and they ordered the hatchet force into the battle. A whole platoon of mountain yards with American leadership were coming to the rescue, but Miller didn't know it. He had been fighting, attacking the enemy, binding his wounds and the wounds of his men. He had seen the mountain yard above him, and now he believed that it wasn't a fantasy. He lay alone in the crater, with his decimated team being tended to by the Bright Light team. One of the rescuers, observing the scene, said, "It looks like Custer's last stand in here." Tears fell from Miller's chin, and the Bright Light team respected him enough to turn their backs so he could grieve alone for a while. The hatchet force retrieved his dead men and his wounded and got them onto the choppers. As befitted any SOG 10, Miller refused to board the last chopper until he was sure that all of his team had been extracted and he was the last man off the battlefield. The team was taken to Dock Tow, where the medics worked on the living and bagged the dead. Another chopper was sent from Pleiku. It loaded the living aboard for the ride to the hospital. Each man had a tag attached to his clothing that asked the question, location of injury. The answer, written in the blank space, said, classified, top secret. When all was said and done, 2 team members had died on the battlefield, 2 died on the operating table, and 3 survived. Hundreds of NVA soldiers died that day. In the hospital, as he recovered from his wounds, Miller was told that he'd been put in for the Silver Star. When higher headquarters read the report, they upgraded the medal to the Distinguished Service Cross. When the report reached Saigon, it was upgraded to the Medal of Honor. President Richard Nixon hung the Medal of Honor around Sergeant Franklin D. Miller's neck on June 15, 1971. After the ceremony, the president asked Sergeant Miller what he would like to do. Miller knew that he could write his own ticket. He looked at the president right in the eye and said, "I'd like to return back to my old unit in Vietnam." The president, somewhat surprised, looked at General Westmoreland, who said, "No problem." Miller was sent back to serve with his unit. I'd like to share with you the credo that Sergeant Miller tried to live by. He said, "Share your fears with yourself and your courage with others. You will inspire people to do things that are incredible." That, in my estimation, sums up the meaning of leadership. Thank God for men like Sergeant Franklin D. Miller, and God bless the United States of America.